Ladies and gentlemen, once again, very warm welcome to the Reinvention Laboratory. I'm Corinna Igra, your host during this Reinvention Laboratory week. We've had a few very interesting days and discussions together, and we have a very exciting session ahead, I'm sure. Insights of the European Commission, the joint initiative on standardization. And I now have the pleasure to introduce to you Kirsten Jona and Hein Bollens. Kirsten Jona is Director for Single Market Regulation and Implementation of the at the EU Commission. And Hein Bollens is Deputy Head of Unit for European Standardization at the EU Commission. So, the two of you are going to take over this session from me. And yeah, I hope you'll have a very interesting discussion and session.
So do I. Thank you, Corinna. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. Okay. We'll bring you today Reinvention Made in Europe. What we want to showcase today with you is the joint initiative, which is a true collaboration between the European regulator, the European standardization community in its broadest sense, standard makers, standard users, regulators. You may, of course, wonder what made us what triggered us to think about reinvention. Regulators, I think just as well as standardization organizations, are not really well known for their creative spirits. But that was true in the past. It's different now. And if I look around, I see it. So, well, it's simple. We had to reinvent because global value chains are global. And regulators, they act within borders. We had to reinvent ourselves because the pace and the depth of technological change, and I saw some very impressive examples outside. And as a consequence, there is a blurring between the borders, of borders between manufacturing, service, and digital. And then, yes, there is also the painful and but undisputed fact we are too slow and too little focused to manage all that. So, how did we in Europe decide to move on from here? Together. That's the master word for us. Standards matter. They are great enablers. They promote and spread innovation. They increase quality and safety. They can create a level playing field. And, important for companies and citizens, they can save cost by eliminating duplication and fragmentation. Now, the question is, which are the standards that matter? I would say the win-win ones that support competitiveness and broader public policy objectives at the same time. We have the Paris Agreement on climate, landmark agreement. We have the issue of digitization of industry. So what we need now, that's what we feel in Europe, is prioritization, focus, collaboration between the broadest possible stakeholder base to deliver. We also need a standardization system with all the different partners that's fit for purpose to deliver. Yesterday, the master words in this room, I understand, were agile and quality. And I'd like to pick up these concepts that you discussed yesterday. That's what we want to achieve with our standardization system. Because of the single market, which is one market of more than 500 million consumers and 28 countries working together, because of that size, Europe is a standardization hub. Our standardization system, Senelec, ETSI, they are a single platform serving different policy areas and companies and citizens from 28 countries. And that's why we wanted to explain to you how we reinvented our standardization system and the way we cooperate in Europe. And with that, I'll give the floor to Hein Bollens to present us the joint initiative.
Thank you, Kerstin. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon, friends of standardization. First of all, I would like to take the opportunity to thank IEC for hosting us here today and to give us the opportunity to speak about this initiative at European level. And in particular, I would like to thank the Senelec president, Bernard Thies, a good friend of ours, that made this possible to be here today and to have this event in front of you. Standardization today is a top priority in the Juncker Commission, be it for the digital single market, be it for the single market strategy as a whole. At the same time, standardization is very hot in Brussels, be it at the council table, be it in the arena of the European Parliament. And as you have all have seen this week, standardization is very hot in Frankfurt. But standardization is also very hot internationally. Look what happens in the TTIP discussions. Look what is happening with the CETA agreement in Canada and with Canada. But also look at the possible trade agreements that we are discussing from region to region. Standardization is always part of those discussions. Ladies and gentlemen, standardization is a common language that everybody understands. The best Hollywood movies, they always start with the end. What you see here, it's the plot. It's our Commissioner Biankowska, who is signing the joint initiative on standardization in Amsterdam, together with the Dutch minister, Henry Kamp, at an event organized in Amsterdam, where most of you here present in the room also participated. Ideas, they do not come out of the blue, as many might think that happens in Brussels. Ideas have been prepared before, and there has been a natural build-up to this joint initiative on standardization. In fact, and Kerstin already mentioned it earlier this afternoon, we have the blurring boundaries between services, traditional manufacturing, and digital. And we are addressing the change in the economic landscape also with the change we would need for European standardization. And we have anticipated this since the year 2010. And this is the first report that you see on screen. There has been a first report in 2010 on the state of play of European standardization. The second report that we have done on the system was called the Independent Review. And many of you here in the room, they will recall all the work and the efforts done to make this good report, looking at five strategic objectives for European standardization. And since 2013, we also have a legal base for European standardization called the European Standardization Regulation 1025. Also, our friend Bernard Thies very often tells us that the best standard is the one that you do not see. And therefore, we need a state-of-the-art system. We need a state-of-the-art standards to make that a reality. And therefore, the Commission's vision for that state-of-the-art European standardization system is threefold. First of all, we look at speeding up the system to have timely standards, but not to the detriment of the quality of the standards. Secondly, we are looking at modernizing the European standardization system. Modernizing the European standardization system, but not to the detriment of inclusiveness of the European standardization system. And thirdly, we are also looking at better prioritizing within the system. And this is needed because today, still, we work too much in silos, be it on the part of legislator, be it on the part of the industry. And I said earlier, the boundaries between traditional manufacturing, between services and digital, they are blurring, and we have to address this. We have to better prioritize within the system, but not to the detriment of the national delegation principle, and not to the detriment of the Dresden and the Vienna agreements. The momentum is here and everywhere to keep standardization very high on the political and the industrial agendas. The more top-down we are, the more bottom-up one has to be. The joint initiative on standardization really was a joint exercise, looking to build further on the successes of the past, but also learning from the weaknesses from the past as well. We have organized a very broad consultation mechanism. We started with a very broad plenary in Brussels. We had an editorial committee, and we also have nowadays a steering committee which is steering the entire exercise. Who is participating in the exercise? Of course, the European standardization organizations, national standardization bodies. We have our SMEs and societal stakeholders on board. We have the member states on board, we have the Commission on board, we have the industrial associations on board, but we also have individual industrial companies on board. And in fact, the reason why we are here today is also because of the success of the joint initiative, because of the reach out of the joint initiative. And there are three reasons for that success. First, the participation of the joint initiative has been entirely voluntary. Nobody was obliged to come to the table in Brussels to discuss. There was a joint feeling from the bottom up that indeed the momentum is there to make a change. Secondly, the debates, the recommendations that we have made, the decisions on the 15 actions have all been taken in a consensual way, consensus-based. And thirdly, and this is a bit contradictory to what sometimes happens in the Commission, we have a light structure. We have a light structure which works in full transparency and openness. I think these are the three main objectives which I really have reached to this success of the joint initiative. Now, looking at the three priorities, the three domains that the Commission is looking at, I mentioned speed, I mentioned modernizing, and I also mentioned better prioritizing within the system. For those three specific areas, we have developed 15 actions of the joint initiative, and some of the speakers will come later on stage to explain a little bit more about those actions. And of those 15 actions, we have three pilot projects. Again, these 15 actions, they do not come out of the blue. These 15 actions have been discussed in more than 15 meetings in Brussels, with voluntary presence of more than 50 participants coming over to Brussels to discuss, because again, they felt that the momentum was there to do something, to make a change. So far, speaking about success, we have more than 100 signatures on the joint initiative on standardization, including the member states of the European Union. And we have not stopped counting for now. Every day, we receive requests to join the joint initiative and to put the signature on it. So far, my part. Of course, if you have questions, we are happy to address them here because this is an interactive session. But if you would like to have more information or possibly be encouraged to sign, this is our email address where you can find more information, and we're very happy to address your questions you might have. Thank you.
Thank you, Hein Bollens. You have the choice now. Either you have some questions already for after Hein's presentation, or you wait to see six of our actions being presented by the project leaders of these actions, and you ask the questions afterwards. So I ask now, do you have a more general question, or you want to keep it for the end? I see you keep it for the end. Then, Hein, over to you.
Okay.
And our
Thank
six
you.
Leaders.
Kerstin. So out of the 15 actions, and of course we're not here to give you just a list of the 15 actions, we thought it was important to highlight at least six important ones. And of course, we have not done this alone. We have done this in a joint partnership because the joint initiative is about reinforcing the public-private partnership that the Commission has with Sensnelec and ETSI and the SMEs and the societal stakeholders. And therefore, we thought it was a very good idea to have them here on stage to present to you shortly the action which is very close to their heart. And therefore, I would like to call Bernard Thies, president of Senelec, on stage to present quickly Action 8. Action 8 is about, and this is also very close to the standardization community, is about providing high quality standards delivered and referenced in a timely manner. Bernard, you have the floor.
Thank you. You said a speed of standardization. I would say timely on the market. And what we are doing today is, if the committee is saying what the market needs is in 1 year, and the others say we need it in 5 years, then we make our publication in the kind, 5 + 1 = 6, divided by 2 = 3, it takes too long time. That is what we do, and that must be changed, because the time delivery is on the market. One is the market need, when the standard must be on the market, and we should control. If they say we need it in 2 years, then you have to control it that in 2 years the market, the standard is on the market then. And if you look to the phase of the harmonized standard, it started with a standardization request. And I think if you go in that area, that at the same time when we are starting the standardization request, we need all the experts on board, all the people who knows the market, and then they can say, okay, we need this standard at that time. And if this standardization request is then accepted by Sen and Senelec and ITSI, then we start and make the standard, and then it's now up to us to do it then in a way that the standard is available very fast. And do you know how long the time is for making an international standard at minimum? Yeah. Somebody has the idea?
Thank you.
6 months, you're right. That's only 6 months to bring an international standard onto the market due to the processes which we have. Sometimes it takes a little bit longer because the consent process is something going in that. And if you're looking what we can do in standardization, you can see it here outside, the TC of the future, new collaboration tools in the future to work more in an efficient way as we do it today. The standards which we are making today is the same as we did it 100 years ago or 110 years ago. We have changed paper to emails, post to emails. We change documents from paper to document server, and then you get a notification email. There is a new standard, a new document. Please download it and give a comment on 100 pages in 4 weeks. And then you are sitting there. How will do that? That is really not efficient, and that must be changed. And now we can change it. You can see it here on the reinvention lab. And then when the standard is ready, then the third phase is, of course, that the standard must be listed in the official journal, because that gives at that time for the companies, the market, the presumption of conformity at the right time. And when we say we have the phase one, phase two, phase three, then we have to reinvent a lot of the processes, make it very, very simple that if the standard is ratified in Senelec and ITSI, it should be then in a very, very short time listed in the official journal. That could be also, if you're looking in reinvention, how to change the processes to that. So that, and if you all agree on this process, process one, second one, making the standard, that is that what Sen, Senelec and ITSI can do. And the rest is then from the other communities who are also then responsible for the timely manner of bringing the standards to the market. Thank you very much. I could tell a little bit more, but I think it's enough at the moment. Dankeschön.
Thank you, Bernard. That means that the Commission should continue speaking with you and the industry with regard to
yes,
that.
And we started already, and that is the action number 6.
Exactly, joint initiative.
Joint initiative.
Thank you very
okay,
much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Let's now go to the second action, which we have number 9. It's an inclusiveness action, which is called inclusiveness, transparency, and effective participation of all stakeholders in the European standardization system. This will be done by one of our societal stakeholders in the European standardization system. The person we have here is Justin Wilkes from ECOS, and he represents the environmental angle in the European standardization system. Up to you.
Thank you, Hein. I'll talk you through action 9, which, as Hein points out, is relating to the inclusiveness and transparency and effective participation of all stakeholders at national, European, and international level. With regard to Annex 3 organisations, which is obviously covered by EU law, the 1025 regulation, we're talking about environmental stakeholders, we're talking about small businesses, we're talking about workers, and we're talking about consumers. It's important from our perspective that Annex 3 are included in the system. We believe that it strengthens the systems. It increases the participation, and we want to see that obstacles are overcome at an international level. And that's what this action is doing. It's going to come up with a series of actions to support easy access to national, European, and international standardization work. At an international level, ECOS is very active in a number of areas. Don't underestimate the importance of the work that the IEC undertakes in terms of decarbonisation of the power system, electrification of the transport system, which is going to be the key way that the transport system is decarbonised, and the promotion of low global warming potential refrigerants that obviously comes out of the Montreal Protocol from many years ago. From our perspective, it's very important that the environmental perspective is taken into account. We believe within the IEC that we are increasing the quality of the standards. We're improving the legitimacy of the system. By our access, you are co-opting a large network of environmental NGOs. We represent 42 environmental NGOs as members, including a number of international actors. And I think the key issue for us, obviously, in our involvement in standardization is we bring that perspective whereby you can then begin to avoid externalities in your standards in terms of environmental pollution, in terms of depletion of material and resources, and climate change. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Justin. Just small detail for the audience and those who are watching us. Annex 3 looks like or sounds like Brussels language. Annex 3 is a annex that we, and I see people nodding in the audience, Annex 3 is the annex to the European Standardization Regulation, where the legislator and the co-legislator find it very important to indeed enrich the process of having societal stakeholders and the SME representative in the European standardization system, and indeed their strength is to make it the system richer and the standards at the end better than it is today. And indeed we have in the joint initiative different actions which relate to inclusiveness and what we call the Annex 3 organizations. And in fact, Annex 3 is indeed Annex number 3 of the regulation of the legal base. So thank you very much. The next presentation we have is on action 10. Again, another inclusiveness item, which is facilitating participation of all stakeholders at national level. So we're not speaking about European level or international level. We speak here also about national level. And there we have our consumers angle represented by the president of ANEC, and ANEC was represented by its president, by Arnold Pindar. Arnold, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Hein, for that introduction. We were told no words on the slide, so I'll leave you to interpret this, but I think I'm talking about the roots, the national level. So I'm very pleased to have this opportunity to introduce Action 10 to you. And as has been said, it's aimed at facilitating the participation of all stakeholders in the standardisation at the national level. And it's very much focused on the national level. This has been a goal of mine for many years, and I'm delighted that the action has been taken up in the Joint Initiative on Standardisation. Whilst the action covers all stakeholders, I shall speak largely from the consumer perspective, which I know best, but much of what I will say will be applicable to other stakeholders, especially the environmental area and other non-governmental organisations, the NGOs, and in some cases, the trade unions and the SMEs. But first, I must thank, actually, it's the French authorities who formally have the leadership on Action 10, and I thank them for achieving such a good plan. Moreover, I must also thank the Commission for taking this innovative approach through the joint initiative itself. It is often said that standards are for business, and as has been shown in a number of studies, it is true to say that businesses gain direct benefits from standardisation. Hence, it is generally not difficult to get experts from manufacturers and suppliers to join technical committees to deliver the standards that their businesses need. The position for other stakeholders is rather different. Taking consumers as an example, although consumers benefit from standards, consumer organisations do not receive any direct benefit from the standardisation process. This is also generally generally the same case for the other NGOs as well. Larger consumer organisations benefit from their magazines and from comparative testing, and all consumer organisations from the campaigning on the major issues of the day. In addition to consumer organisations receiving no direct benefits from standardisation, consumers often believe, incorrectly in my view, that regulation gives certainty of consumer protection, whilst voluntary standards provide less certainty of protection. I often say that the United Kingdom consumer organisations and the Confederation of British Industry have one thing in common. They need to frighten their members. Business is doing this to us, government is doing that to us, and hence you need to remain members so that we can protect you. Standardisation does not provide headlines in the news, and it is therefore difficult for even large, successful consumer organisations to see value in taking part in standards work. National standards bodies have open-door policies for the participation of all stakeholders. However, this is not enough where there is no direct financial or other organisational benefit from participating. In addition, in some countries there are financial barriers, even if membership charges are moderate. So, in developing the Action 10, six tasks have been identified. Firstly, to define the underrepresentation with a question as to how it can be assessed. Secondly, to identify what we know about the representation of those underrepresented stakeholders. Thirdly, to identify obstacles that the various categories of underrepresented stakeholders are confronted with. And fourthly, to evaluate the impact of underrepresentation. We then need to define the objective to be pursued in terms of improvement, criteria, indicators, and further to identify areas of improvement in terms of the nature of improvement and the areas of standardisation. But if Action 10 is to be a success, three things must happen. Above all, national standards bodies must commit and engage. Secondly, funding must be available from one or more sources for training and capacity building activities over an extended period to consolidate any progress made. And thirdly, I believe there is a need for a dedicated and well-resourced champion, ideally within each national standards body, to support and encourage the weaker stakeholders. At international level, ISO-COPOLCO, this is the International Organization for Standardization's Committee on Consumer Policy, has an active working group on consumer participation and training. ISO-COPOLCO has had some success in facilitating consumer participation in standardisation, particularly in developing countries. ISO, supported mainly through its Developing Countries Fund, has arranged training events, often continuing over several days, to bring together consumer organisations to work with representatives from their related national standards bodies. There has also been some support from developed countries through, for example, overseas development aid. And here I notably mention Germany, that's done some good work. I would welcome the IEC joining ISO on this important activity aimed at a more inclusive standardization process to meet the challenges of a global and digitized work. And we should not forget the key role that public authorities, such as market surveillance, can play by participating in standardization. They are entrusted with the role to enforce safety and conformity legislation and de facto the standards linked to it. Their contribution is invaluable in order to develop standards with a high level of consumer and public interest protection. So in summary, how can we achieve increased participation of all stakeholders in standardization work? We need a more formal assessment of the problems and potential solutions. We need to develop a strategy to deliver solutions which may differ in different countries, different cultures, and different economies. We need broader participation of all stakeholders in standardization, both to give a legitimacy to the standardization process, but mainly to ensure that published standards are robust, market relevant, and fully fit for purpose. So finally, I believe that Action 10 of the Joint Initiative provides a unique opportunity to make a real difference to the participation of underrepresented stakeholders in standardization and standardization. And I look forward to the success of this initiative. Thank you.
Thank you, Arnold. I think, and also the audience here can agree, that standards is not only standards from machine to machine, it's also standards from machine to consumers. So we could also invent an M, as in your language you speak about M2M, it's an M and then two digit and M. We should also invent an M two digit C, machine to consumer.
Yeah, and I think the world is getting more and more complicated in that we have consumers selling to consumers, because it's a really complex world that we're now living in.
Exactly.
And standards need to rise to that. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Arnold. Then to the next action, which is a little bit something different, because we already spoke about the boundaries which are disappearing between traditional manufacturing, digital and services. And in fact, in the first June package of the Commission that we issued on standardization, we also have made an attempt as Commission to give some guidance on service standards. And therefore, also in the joint initiative, we have developed action number 12, which is about encouraging the greater development and use of European service standards to help integrate Europe's service markets. And therefore, we have invited the Vice President Technical in SEN. I will not try to express your name, but I will start with your first name. Your name is a bit too difficult for me. Gudrun, please, you have the floor.
Thank you, Hein. It's not at all difficult. Ragnvaldardóttir.
Okay, thank you. Can this be standardized somehow?
Or? It is standardized, but it's an Icelandic standard.
Okay, good. Not the European one.
We're not bringing that to the European level yet.
Okay.
Okay, I was asked to come here to talk about the action number 12, which is about encouraging the greater development and use of European standards, European service standards, to help integrate Europe's service markets. And why are we doing that? Why is this action on the list? The world economy is increasingly becoming a service economy. This is primarily due to the increasing importance and share of the service sector in the economies of most developed and developing countries. In Europe, services account for 70% of the economic activity and a similar proportion of the total employment. So the services sector is therefore a key element contributing to the overall output and competitiveness of European economy. Traditionally, of course, standardization has mainly been associated to goods. The number of European standards in the area of services is therefore in the area of services has nevertheless increased in recent years, but the number is still small. It's only between 1% and 2% of income in comparison to the total number of European standards and the economic importance of the service sector in Europe. The lower development of European standards for services leads to missed opportunities for European service producers who are looking to offer their services across borders. So service users from their side are also not able to benefit from a wider range of service offers. So the use of European standards can contribute to fostering cross-border trade, as well as enhancing safety, quality and performance, and of course, ensuring the protection of consumers and the environment. Nevertheless, services is a rather new field of standardization, and stakeholders do not always understand how standardization can be used and its potential benefits. Although I must add here that the standardization of services is not all that new. Over 20 years ago, I was working as a technical officer in the Central Secretariat in Brussels, and I was responsible for the field of standardization of services. And it was around that time that we set up in CEN the first technical committees in the field of services. But still, there is a need to further exploit the potential of service standardization at European level, and also to build on the existing national experiences on service standardization. That is, the existing national standards, national roadmaps and strategies on service standardization. And here I would like to mention, for example, the DIN here in Germany, the DIN roadmap, and in France, the AFNOR white paper on services. In addition, due to our close links with ISO and IEC, existing relevant international standards for services will also be considered. So what do we want to achieve? The aim of this action is to promote, where appropriate, the increased development and use of market-driven European service standard to the benefit of European businesses, consumers, and service users and providers in general. In order to achieve this overall objective, we will work towards identifying priority sectors that can benefit most from European service standards, increasing awareness and understanding about standardization in the area of services, and a greater involvement of service providers and users in services standardization. How are we going to achieve this? In order to achieve these objectives, CEN, with the contribution of all stakeholders, will develop and implement a strategy for standardization in support of services, of the services sector. A first draft of this strategy has been published at the end of last week on the CEN website, and will be open for commenting until the 15th of November. So you have the opportunity to contribute to this. The draft strategy outlines a series of actions that are intended to be carried out in 2017 and 2018 and beyond in order to reach the objectives of Action 12. The draft strategy describes a series of criteria that will allow to identify priority sectors with the biggest potential to benefit from European standards in the area of services. CEN and its members would then engage with the identified sectors to further discuss the needs and whether there is support for standardization. The strategy and the actions defined in it will also contribute to increasing awareness about service standardization and further engage with service stakeholders in order to better understand their needs and how they can benefit from European standardization in this area. And finally, I would like to invite you all to participate in a workshop on services that will be organized by CEN in Brussels on the 26th of October. The workshop will discuss the state of play and challenges for European businesses to improve their competitiveness and offer their services across borders, identify solutions to unlock the potential of the service market and meet those challenges. And the input received during the workshop will help to shape the services strategy under development in the framework of this action. Thank you.
Thank you, Gudrun. I think this is a very good example, services, that the GIST, the Joint Initiative for Standardization, is really anticipating the changing elements in the economic landscape. To give you a few figures, and also for the audience, for the moment we are not using the full potential of services and service standards in Europe and the rest of the world. Only 7% of services are for the moment traded cross-border in the EU, where for products, this is almost 100% because of the single market.
That's right.
And 75% of our GDP is represented by the service sector. Mm-hmm. But, and this is more striking, only 2% of the European standards are service standards. So there's a lot of potential to be done, and I think the joint initiative indeed, and in particular this action, will contribute to making and to creating more awareness about service standards. Thank you very much. Good run.
Thank you.
Speaking about anticipation, we have had the part on services, but there is also the part on digital. Again, addressing the blurring situation between manufacturing, services and digital. And as you know, there has been an initiative taken also at the level of the European Union with regard to the digital single market. We have also the single market strategy, but the digital single market is one of the flagships of this Juncker Commission. And the digital market is indeed, and the strategy is indeed, addressing the need for Europe to take leadership in what needs to be done in the digital sphere, be it for 5G, IoT, cybersecurity, and so on. Also, in the Joint Initiative on Standardization, we have a particular action on that. And this is Action 14, which is called Standardization to Support Digitization of European Industry. Margot Dore, the director in ETSI, which is doing the ICT standards in the standardization world in Europe, she will speak about that action and how they see standardization in the digital world.
Thank you very much, Hein. This action was defined, and first of all, I'm here as ETSI, but I represent the three leaders of this action, which are Sense and Lake and ETSI, actually, and a number of co-leaders, which are also in the room, or co-sponsors, because DIN, DKE, and other standard organizations are involved in this action. When we started thinking about this action, we started realizing what are we going to add to this with standards? What can standardization in the scope of the Joint Initiative on Standardization add? Most of our organizations are active one way or the other on digitization of industry. And digitization of industry is actually a fact of life. So how are you going to make something that makes sense out of this action? The first thing that came to our mind, precisely because we're all active, and here I would like to make a little comment on what Kerstin Jorna said, with all due respect. You said Senelec and ETSI are a single platform. I'm sorry, but I don't think this is true. And that's part of the challenge we have in this action. There are existing platforms which already develop a number of standards. There are some, DKE is one, DKE and IEC. There are ETSI with its platform with 1M2M. There are other platforms in the world who all, one way or the other, work on those issues. So the question we asked ourselves was actually, what value can we add with an action like this in the frame of the joint initiative that will make a difference? And the whole issue we are starting to look at is how and what are we going to coordinate? Coordinate to try and make sense for European competitiveness and the internal market, which is what DG Grow is in charge of. So we started looking at different animals, as it's put on the slides, to try and see which kind of animals do we want in the room, bearing in mind that this joint initiative will probably not be producing standard, but actually doing more some coordination work. So it's not about reinventing the wheel. We try and take the best out of the different platforms to try and make something that's useful in the scope of the joint initiative. We also want to cater to new standardization ways. There are many standards existing that relate to digitization of industry, and again, it's very broad terms. In the different sectors. One of the difficulties is, and we all know this as standardizer, and I'm sure IEC has the same issues as in ETSI when we work on different subjects, it's putting people and sectors, different sectors in the same room and trying to get them to understand each other, not even start working together, but already speaking the same language. We were last week in with people from energy and energy telcos. In my case, it's telcos. Telcos and banking, telcos and transport, etc. We just don't speak the same language. Maybe this is something that you guys in IEC have managed to find a sort of Esperanto of standardization. I think personally, and we think this is the first thing that we can do. We also want to cater to all the forms of standardization. There was a time when it was going from basic research to R&D to standardization, validation, certification, testing, you name it, market access. Today, sometimes it starts with implementation, and then you test the implementation. Actually, outside so that there is some kind of virtual implementation mechanisms or virtual testing and certification mechanism, very interesting presentation I had outside. We need to factor this in to say what is happening and what are we going to do with this for the benefit of the internal market and European competitiveness. So what are we doing with this? We're trying to focus on a few sectors because if we say we're going to take care of digitization of industry in the next 2 years in the scope of the joint initiative, I mean, I think this would be a lie. So we're trying to focus a little bit the actions. This is actually under discussion, and including with the European Commission, because as you heard from Hein and from Kerstin, there are a number of initiatives coming from the Commission, and we try to defragment, and we try jointly to defragment, let's say, but it's not that obvious. So we are currently looking for the two focus sectors that would be the most the most priorities that we want to work on, etc. We think there is enough work for all the different animals to coexist in this sector and actually to cooperate very well. We think the threat is not organization X against organization Z against organization Y, but the threat is between standardized and proprietary. Because at the end of the day, it's about inclusion of other players that did not participate in the standards making and the inclusion of all sorts of players in the economic game that standards support. And we are very bullish about the fact that it's not about finding a platform, a single platform or so, but it's all about interfaces. And this, in telecom, we're quite used to it, and we want to look at these interfaces. With this, I will leave you with this extract from a speech of Commissioner Vestager last week, which actually said exactly what is something which is very useful in the scope of this, in the context today. We can only do it by understanding and respecting the differences and finding ways to work together on the things we have in common. Seeing differences not as a threat, but as something interesting, something we can learn from, and something we can wonder about. And I leave you with this statement. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Margot. So I think also in general, she spoke a little bit about getting out of the silos, but also keeping a little bit the silos at the same time, working cross-cutting across the board. So indeed, getting out of the silos, and this is one of the elements that we have seen in the digital single market strategy that was presented in the European Union. We see that in Europe we have 350 million citizens or connections to the internet. And if we would have a fully functioning digital single market, we would gain 450 billion euros. 450 billion euros would be gained in the economy the next 5 years if the digital single market would be fully applied. So also there, not only for services, but also for the digital, there is an enormous potential. And we are working on that. The next on the list is Action 15, the last action. And we thought in the group it was important not only to have actions as such, but you sometimes have to do some pilot actions as well, pilot projects to try something out. And this leadership for this action is taken by the SME angle, as we call it, the Annex II organizations, but we call it the SME representation in the European standardization system. And to give you an example, of course, most of you know that 99% of the businesses in Europe, they are SMEs. and they contribute to the highest employment in the EU as employer in the EU. So they have a very strong interest to be present in the European standardization system, and also that their voice is heard, not only at European level, but also at international level. And therefore, we have invited Crystal Davidson. She is the director in SBS, responsible of indeed making sure that the voice of the SMEs in the European standardization system is heard. Action 15 is about improved representation of the interests of the SMEs in Europe in international standardization processes. Crystal, up to you.
Is it working? Yes. Okay. Well, thank you very much for this invitation, and thank you, Hein, for the introduction. I think, indeed, you've explained it well. I would just like to start by saying that it might be Action 15, but it's not the least important, and I'm still trying to convince the Commission next time that we have an event or something to put Action 15 as Action 1 to reverse the order for once. It might make it a bit nice for us. But as I said, last action, but definitely not the not the least important. And precisely, why is it important? Well, it's important simply because standards are increasingly being developed at international level, and in Europe we are increasingly using them. They're being increasingly transposed at European level, and it's therefore important to ensure that the views of the SMEs are represented at the decision-making level. And what I'm saying here for European SMEs is actually applicable to all the SMEs in the other regions of the world. I think it's important for all SMEs to be involved in the whole standardization process at international level. It's fair to say that there are tools already there to facilitate the participation of SMEs at national level, and also even there are tools out there such as the Guide 17, which was originally produced by Sensenelec, and this guide is really designed to for the drafting of the standards to make them SME friendly. This guide has been taken up by ISO and IEC, so you know these are measures which are very positive. And in the framework of this specific Action 15, what's happening is that these co-sponsors, that's what we are called actually, the sponsors and the co-sponsors have actually identified the promotion of this Guide 17 as one of the key elements. At ISO and IEC level, perhaps it's not sufficiently well known yet, and we therefore will be engaging in an awareness campaign for the standard drafters in this to make sure that these standards, these guidelines are also used at international level to profit all SMEs. So this is more on the practical level. There's also an important dimension when we talk about SMEs, and that's the political dimension. And this is why there is an initiative or an action, a task, which is foreseen, which is to reinforce the collaboration between, sorry, the Annex 3, you know, those weaker people, and the European standardization organizations and the international ones. What we need to do is to engage in a more structured dialogue with them. And we do have some concrete proposals regarding this, which is to make sure that there are two high-level meetings a year, so very high-level meetings, between these ESOS, the Annex 3s, and the IEC. And we're even actually saying that we should go beyond this and to extend all interested groups. The reason why it's so important to also engage at political level is precisely to make, for everybody to understand, and also for the SME representatives to understand what are the challenges, but also what are the opportunities, and to open the door to a better collaboration between the different entities. Because as an SME operating at national level, what's also happening is that you feel that things are getting even further away from where you are. So it used to be national, now it then became European, now it's international. And it's important that the SMEs in their local region or their area feel that they can still participate and that they are still being heard at the international level. The there's many tasks, but another one I would like to reinforce as a concrete action is the proposal that we have to actually make sure that to set up at Sensenelec, you have an SME working group, for instance. We would like this to be extended or to basically make sure that the other organizations such as ISO, IEC, and ETSI, but I know ETSI's setting it up, this would allow us as well to make sure that the views of SMEs across the world are basically heard and that they also understand the challenges and what's happening, because at the end of the day, I think what we all want is for standards to be taken up. And if you want standards to be taken up, then they need to be SME friendly, and SME friendly in the sense of even those SMEs that are only standard users need to make sure, well, we need to make sure that they also want to engage and that they also want to turn to standards. So I think these are, just in a sort of nutshell, more or less some of the key tasks that we've actually identified under this. Once again, as the picture shows, with the hope of actually trying to bridge this sometimes misunderstanding between the SMEs and, in general, the ESOs and the ISOs and IECs. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Krista. Thank you for that. There is, in fact, a big difference between the SMEs in the European standardization system and the other three societal stakeholders. The other three, as we have heard them, we have heard two out of three of them today, is the consumers, the environment, but also the workers. The big difference with the SME angle is that they are not only standard makers in the system, they're also the standard users in the system. And they represent 99% of our businesses. So we indeed think it's very important that their voice is heard in the European standardization system. So thank you again. Kerstin, would you like to join me on the podium for
the questions?
For the possible questions, and then to conclude.
There now was you've a lot. Heard. You've heard six out of the 15 initiatives. I don't know if there's anyone you prefer, you liked really well. I just recap, we talked about timeliness, we talked about transparency, we talked about participation not only at interregional but also at national level. We talked about services standards, the new frontier. We talked about digitization of industry, and we talked about the representation of SMEs. Are there now questions that you would like to field? All our sponsors are here. A question from a sponsor.
Dr. Thies.
Thank you. Before I make my question, I would like to explain in what area I see the question. If you look to the digital world, we have the Internet of Things on the bottom line, the Internet of Service on the upper line, in the middle between, we have five domains. One domain is industry, energy, mobility, health, and living the citizen. So we have everybody on board between these systems which is running in the future in the digital world. Then on the bottom line, we have, of course, things something like safety. The product must be safe for everything in all the domains. We have cyber security for all the domains. We have to find out standardization for that in a general and maybe some special in of the five domains. And on the upside, you have then the Internet of Services, how to make the service, and we are talking about services to that. Give you one example, maybe in a few years, you will never pay for a washing machine. You will get it free of charge every 2 years, a new one, or updated with new software. But you pay for washing, for using the products. And that is then a totally new world for the business in the future, in the digital world, if you are using then these Internet of Things together with the Internet of Services. And now my question is, who is setting the priorities in this whole world? Do you have an idea, Hein?
I look to my director.
I look to the audience. There are much smarter people here who come from different walks of life. I think the priorities that will emerge as business models will emerge. That would be my answer. And it's the consumer voice coming back to your washing machine. Anybody wants a product that works and facilitates life. So that will, consumer choice will be a big driver, I would say.
If I may add to that as part of the reply to the question, is that standardization is a voluntary issue, a voluntary thing, but also market relevance is very important. And as Kerstin said, indeed, the market will do an uptake of the standard only if there is market relevance for it. And indeed, the Internet of Things will, at the end, when it works, will connect 30 billion devices. 30 billion devices. And how to make a standard out of 30 billion devices so that the 30 billion devices speak to each other. Sometimes being married and in a couple, it's already difficult to communicate, or to standardize communication from one to one. What we need is indeed a system which is able, capable, and adapted to a system which is able to speak, and having speaking 30 billion devices to each other.
That's a question.
Yeah, I was not waving. My name is Willem Wolf. I'm from the Netherlands Electrotechnical Committee, and I very much like this question because, as I understand it, the market has a standardization agenda and the European Committee has a standardization agenda. But even the European Committee is making regulation requiring published standards. So I think you already had a priority. So how do you do that? Because before you're making law, you should already discuss this with the industry or with the stakeholders. What is the priority? So how do you do that? Because I think there are two different worlds, and only in the small overlap you can prioritize.
If this is a question to us as the regulator, who is the minority in this room, I would say it's democracy and elections. And as far as the European Commission is concerned, we have the 10 Juncker priorities, which are the 10 headline goals that that drive the political agenda of this commission. And you have digitization, you have single market, you have the EU as a global actor. And this in cooperation with the member states and the Council and the European Parliament, this is our agenda.
I would like to add to that as well, that we have something unique in Europe. We have many things which are unique. But we have something unique in European standardization, which is the MSP, the multi-stakeholder platform, where the ICT community speaks, at least with each other, but also with industry in the room, but also with the legislator in the room. And they discuss the priorities, what they see fit best for the next years. And their work is being fed in to the work of the legislator, what we have in the committee. In the committee, you have the member states, which discuss amongst each other together with us, and which set the priority in a legislative way. But this is being picked up, because in our annual union work program, the yearly program that we have ICT priorities. And for next year, for example, the three big priorities are digital. And for digital, we look at 5G, Internet of Things, and cybersecurity. This is in our annual union work program, adopted by the member states in comitology, again, a Brussels world comitology, but it's done in a legislative way. So digital is indeed being addressed at both levels.
But Bernhard, you kind of led us into the kind of grilling the commission setup. Now, in fact, what we would like to offer you, because we have the sponsors of these actions here, is do you have questions to the sponsors and to their actions and how they do it?
Thank you very much for this. And first of all, let me thank you for this session and for the broad overview of information you offered. That's been extremely helpful and interesting. And I made so many notes I'm going to look up in the internet now after this. Because I think living in a century of information, how to handle the information and get all relevant information is key for all of us. Now, I may be a little bit exotic. My name is Anja Sørensen. I may be a little bit exotic in here because I'm busy in the construction industry. So something about industry and materials, etc. And I'm very much active in different SEN as well as national committees of standardization. I would like to raise the issue of timing. And I absolutely agree with everything you said on we need to be focused, we need to prioritize, and we need to speed up because we are developing standards for those who are about to use the standards, and they should be robust and they should be fit for purpose, and there should be a sense in, so a demand in, so we need to have them available pretty soon. On the other hand, most of the people, were, as far as I'm aware, most of the people active in the standardization works do that on a more or less voluntary basis. The employers delegate people. Whoever does that, that's not our first priority job. And there's, I feel that people have so many things they struggle on, like, for example, all these information. Find your way through all these information regulations, everything changes. You mentioned the point of citation in the official journal. You finished a job, and then you're waiting for 2.5 or 3 years until your standards are cited in the official journal, and the products can be CE marked against that. What's within this initiative, is there what's there to facilitate the work for those who are developing the standards and who would like to get them off their desk because they have a lot to work on as well? Maybe it's a stupid question, but that's my, my perspective.
That's why
thank
I give
you.
It
And it's good that you, thank you for the question, it's good that you brought it up because in particular, we have an action, not only an action, we have even a pilot project in the joint initiative which is addressing the construction sector. We know in Europe on our side, but also on the industry side, there are concerns with regard to the construction product regulation. So in a specific pilot project, we want to learn as well from our side, as the industry side, as the society side, how to better implement the different provisions of that construction product regulation. I think we can learn from each other with regard to implementation of the rules and to make them indeed fit for use by industry and also for publication. And of course, the joint initiative is only a starting point. We have until the end of the Juncker Commission, the end of 2019, to deliver. And there is indeed a commitment to deliver also on that pilot project for construction product. And we have a very broad participation, not only from the industry, not only from SEN and Senelec, but also from inside the Commission to make sure that we can reach those objectives to have a better understanding, especially with regard to the construction sector. So I'm quite hopeful that this will emerge and deliver by the end of 2019, but also through the different steps in the next months to come.
Are there other questions?
Yeah. Thank you. The question was related to the Action 8. When we were talking about the initiative standardization, first we talked it standardization pact and then we changed it to that. And exactly what you were telling before, that was our idea when we are talking about the future of standardization in a common view to change these things in the future. And that is the starting point. And if you remember, that was last year in Riga on the General Assembly of SEN and Senelec, then we started the process. And now we are already formulated the actions to start to that. And we are really make the reinvention of the whole system of the standardization. It was exactly the idea that things which are you brought up will we never be in the next 2 or 3 years. It takes some time. And that was really the initiative. We are talking now to each other and then we find out a way to do it together for the future, have a better system in standardization in the future. And that, I think, was the main goal when we were talking together in Riga. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
If I can build on that, between PACT and joint initiative, this is something what I said early at my intervention today. PACT looks like or sounds like Brussels language, something top down. We conclude the PACT with you, and then we see whether you respect the law and the PACT that we have signed. At the end, this is not what we wanted. We have changed the wording, but also the way how we do it. Bottom up. The more top down you are, the more bottom up you have to be. And this is why we called it the joint initiative.
Yes, please.
Thank you. Detlef Dessler from Dean. I also want to like to stress the point of timely manner for the standards, not just for the construction part. It's action 5, I think we're talking about that, but for action 8, when you said we're talking with the experts and they need a standard in 2 years, there might be two time frames. First of all, just a normal standard, just in brackets, a normal standard, and then a standard who has to be cited in the official journal. When they need this in 2 years, perhaps we can have a time frame together with the Commission that the experts will say, okay, we will be ready with the standard in 1.5 years, in 18 months, and then the Commission has also half a year or has half a year, and then we can say, okay, it will be cited within the official journal in 2 years. So at the moment, it's right, we are, the experts are running faster and faster, and at the end they have to wait and they do not know how long they have to wait. Perhaps we can make a time frame together with the Commission and say, okay, when you need this in 2 or 3 years, we need the standards in 1.5 years or 2, so then we can cite it in the official journal in a special time frame and not in a time frame the experts don't know when they start the work. The question is, might it be possible with CEN and CENELEC and the Commission together to have a time frame for the standards to be cited in the official journal when it's a mandated one?
Yeah, that is exactly what we started in the joint initiative. To everybody is on board when we start and everybody leaves the boat when it's end. So everybody knows what he has to do, that we say in 2 years, it must be on the market, and all the phase one, phase two, and phase three are working so big together that in 2 years we have it. And we have to change something, that is reinvention. And all experts which are working in the three phases has to work now together. I know it's not easy, but you have a starting point to do that, and that is the initiative. Thank you.
Are there other questions? Because we still have a little film for you. Ah, okay.
Erik Janssens, European Organization for Quality. Thank you. But may I ask a critical question? Is there an action group 16 or an action point 16? Because I have a little bit of a problem with European standards for the 21st century in a global world. When you develop everything for Europe, what's happening then from Asia, America? Are we still in line? Because in equality organizations, we notice that the American organization is very active and is really using their standards and to put them on our European world.
I think the fact that we are here, and thank you for the invitation also from my part, shows that we want to work together, and there is no way we can, you know, put it into one country or several countries. The value chains are global, and that's why we are here. And the cooperation between the European standardization system and the international IEC system is very, very intense and very, very rich. And there's a lot of work going on together and in parallel. And many European standards, the vast majority, to be honest, in your area, in the IEC area, is kind of derived from IEC work. So yeah. I think that's a very good example, actually.
If I can give another example to that, is that, of course, it's about global value chains that we are living in nowadays. And there should be no competition between the different regions with regard to standards. There should be convergence. There should be working together rather than discussing the differences. Mm. And, of course, the example that we always use for standardization in Europe is about the GSM standard, which was developed in Europe. But we also have 4G in Europe. And we were very quick in developing it in Europe. But we were very late in implementing 4G. If you look at the map of Europe and you would see the map of 4G coverage, there is still a lot of work to be done. And if we speak about 5G, it's very important that also there, with all the technology that we have in Europe, with all the brains that we have in Europe, coming out of the best education systems of the world, we have to use those brains to make sure that 5G remains on the top of the political and industrial agenda, and also there Europe can take the leadership in developing 5G. I think this is also a good example why we have to take these initiatives.
I suggest now that we see
Thank you.
Regarding the international work, the initiative shows that all the standards should be international standards. We have already the Vienna Agreement between CEN and ISO, and we have at the moment the Dresden Agreement between CENELEC and the IEC, and that will be tomorrow the Frankfurt Agreement. To go much more in all the technical work which are showing in my picture with the Internet of Things and Internet of Service at the international level. Because the market is internationally, it's not in Europe, it's internationally. And also then if you look to the digital market in Europe, it is the same market than in China or in US if you can work together. And that is also part of the initiative. Thank you.
Thank you. So, with the compliments of CEN-CENELEC, we'll now see the film about how it all happened, actually, on the joint initiative.
Joint initiative on standardization is built on three pillars: to modernize the system, to better prioritize within the system, and also to speed up the system to have timely standards.
We are here to join the standardization community in defining a series of actions to contribute to a better interaction between the European standardization community, Commission and EFTA.
It's an open invitation by the Commission, and I think we need to collaborate and grab this opportunity to make the standards as good as possible and also to fit it into the complete system.
We have embarked in this journey with a view to contribute to improve the standardization system.
I think there was a need to establish a more direct link between the European Commission and the industry. And I think within GIS, there are a certain number of topics where we have the opportunity to do that.
We have to ensure that the industry finds in the European standardization system what it is looking for. And what it is looking for is an efficient way and secure way to put their products on the market.
You are having a world where together with the product, no matter what product, you're also buying a services. In the product there's an electrotechnical part, there is a mechanical part, and there is more and more ICT present. So I think the old models of the past, which have worked perfectly, will have to take into account these things.
It's not only modernizing the standardization system, it's the fact that we are modernizing the world, like digitalization of Europe. So I think we try to make the pace of standards at the same as the pace of society.
To me, standards need to be market driven. If there's no market request, if there is no market need, then there is no need for a standard.
Speeding the process means that you can also jeopardize the consensus building process, the quality of the standards, and therefore timeliness is preferable over speed.
A standard is not good if it is not the result of a consensus process, and consensus takes time. It doesn't need to take too much, but it doesn't need to be quick. Quick doesn't mean good.
We are able to keep the jobs, the growth and competitiveness in Europe, something that we really need to keep the leadership in Europe for industries and for citizens. So therefore the best standard we have is the standard that you do not see, and therefore we have to closely work together with the standardization community. A bottom-up approach is very important to reach that objective.
Now, if you think you have too much information, here's the three takeaways for you. The triple T standard. Transparency. Everybody has to be in. It's a way to participate. Timeliness, not speed. Timeliness at the right moment on the market, and all have to work together. And the most important T is together. It's services and products, it's standard makers, standard users, it's public, private, it's digital, it's analog, and you can prolong this. The important thing is together. So, triple T, if you remember that, you will see what we've been working on together for the last year, and I was very happy that we could present this to you today. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Kirsten Jona and Hein Wollens, for giving us that deep insight into your initiative. Thank you also to the rest of the speakers. I just say like that. That was great, and I think we really had we profited from that a lot. Thank you all for attending this session and for making possible such an active and engaged discussion on this important topic.
IEC General Meeting 2016. Connecting Communities. Reinvent Standardization.